the STG Pavilion, and a very special hello to all of our guests on Facebook watching here. We do these Facebook Lives because we want to bring more of the action of COP25 to people who aren't able to be here in Madrid with us. And today we have an excellent guest who is going to talk about the links between climate change and migration. So, a very warm welcome to Dina Ionesco, head of the Migration, Environment, and Climate Change Division for the International Organization for Migration, or IOM. So thank you for being here.
Hello, thank you for the invitation.
Sure. And so just to give us a base for jumping off, how, broadly speaking, how does climate change affect migration?
So climate change affects in many, many ways migration. First of all, we can have examples of sudden onset events like typhoons that are exacerbated by climate change and are more frequent over the past years that lead directly to the displacement of people having to move. And then we have the adverse effects of climate change on a very long time perspective. If we look at a scenario of 1.5 or 2.20 degree increase, mean many things for human mobility, because extreme heat will affect, for instance, if people can live in a place, sea level rise will affect all the people living in deltas, for instance. So we have all these different elements combined together.
Yes, and it sounds like it's not just climate change, but different SDGs that are related.
Yes, completely. I think it's very important to realize that the environmental drivers are mixed to many, many other drivers, economic or demographic or political as well. And when we speak of the sustainable development goals, it's extremely important for better understanding what we mean by migration and climate change. We can quote quite a number of them as important for migration issues. For instance, if you have oceans, we speak a lot at this COP about oceans, it's called a blue COP. And so we can have examples now of sea level rise and coastal erosion affecting populations. We can have also the SDG on land, that's very important, because land degradation or good land management has an impact whether people can stay or have to move. Gender SDGs keep, because we are very unequal to climate change effects in terms of migration. In some situations, women are unfortunately the most vulnerable, but we have cases when men are the most vulnerable. For instance, very difficult heat construction situation or mining industry. So we can quote, in fact, all the SDGs. One very important one is the energy one, I think, because we are having now much more awareness that we need clean energy in displacement situations, in camps. Also for people who have had to move, we count the four that the migration has a negative impact also on the environment.
Absolutely. So can you tell us a little bit about what your organization, IOM, is doing to talk about this broad 2030 agenda and really make it impact the lives of the migrants?
So I work for an organization that is intergovernmental and a UN organization. So it works a lot with states, and IOM, it's an organization mandated on migration. So we work a lot with states on their migration policies and practices so that their policies have an impact then on the lives of migrants or of the communities. What I find extremely interesting for IOM is that now, as a migration-mandated organization, we have nevertheless put climate change extremely high as a priority on our work agenda. So, in a way to say that the contemporary migration is really, really impacted by climate change, and also that we have a vision that we need better migration policy because we know the impact of climate change on people movement and human mobility. So it's an organization that advances knowledge. So we have a lot of research ongoing in different hotspots. It's an organization that's very hands-on, so there's a lot of operational work to respond to disasters. For instance, now in the Bahamas, it's one example, but also Mozambique or just now in Sudan. And there are a lot of work also at communication level, advocating for the connection between migration and climate. people's stories. So we have brought together quite a number of beautiful stories that are both sad and beautiful and positive, full of hope and despair in a mixed way. And I really encourage everyone to go and see these stories. They are gathered in different campaigns. One of these campaigns is called Find a Way. And it tells about stories of people affected by extreme heat, by too much water, not enough water. So all these environmental drivers impacting migration in Colombia, in the Bahamas, in the Micronesia, Madagascar. So it gives a face and a human story to what we are doing also at policy level.
Yeah, I think that's critical because we, as UN employees, we can spend a lot of time in conferences like this, but it's really about reaching the people around the world, the most vulnerable, like you mentioned, who live in low-lying countries who are threatened by sea level rise. We have women, as you mentioned as well, who lead our voices and our supports and bringing campaigns like you mentioned here is a great way.
I would say also we should not undermine what is going on here at the COP, because I think it's key to speak of migration in all these ways, policy way, technical and human stories, but what is happening here at the COP is key for us, because we are advancing work with states on connecting migration issues to the climate change policies, as much adaptation as mitigation. We have a task force working on climate change and displacement under the United Nations Framework Convention umbrella. So I think there's a clear role that gives us much more means and anchorage. And I really believe working for an intergovernmental organization that it's equally important to continue to speak with policymakers and not to forget that policymakers are also, at the end of the day, human beings.
Good point to remember, absolutely. Lastly, if I could just ask you, are there any good examples of good policies that you've seen around the world, something that could be scaled up maybe? Just curious.
Yes, I think we are increasing now also our knowledge on good practices. There are different types of practices we can highlight. As an intergovernmental organization, we work on many projects around the world. I would see on climate change and migration very good practice at regional level. We have, for instance, in the Pacific, programs at regional level that support the countries from the Pacific in their vision to have a regional framework addressing climate change and migration issues. We have national examples that are extremely interesting, like the example of Fiji, for instance, who's championing the idea that countries have to be prepared to climate change and migration-related issues. We have countries as Vanuatu that really are developing new policies that connect issues of displacement, adaptation, climate change. We have a lot of examples from the Caribbean, for instance, of new regional discussions that bring together countries that have decided to adapt their migration policies to better take into account this displacement and migration-related issues. And I would say what has changed at operational level beyond the humanitarian response, that it's about assisting people displaced by disaster, I think what has changed and it's key is the awareness that you in fact can bring an environmental twist and philosophy and approach to all our projects. So we are much more considering whether diaspora should invest back home in green job, or whether people who return to their country can return with land rehabilitation packages. So it's spread much more throughout everything we do. And I think this is maybe the biggest cultural change that we are seeing over the past years.
Wonderful. Lastly, actually, this is a true last question. For our Facebook audience there, you know, these are people who are interested in UN issues. What can they do to, they're not here at COP, to sort of take action to represent migrants, to be an ally?
I think there are many, many things that can be done. And I really believe that each individual has to go in accordance to their own personalities and talents and dreams and go towards what they think is best. for instance, to support our campaigns. You can also just fund and contribute with some funding to the campaigns that then goes into IOM's action on climate change and migration. You can also be very innovative and, for instance, as an artist, speak about our topics but with artistic vision through paintings or poetry. I think this is wonderful. I think it's key for the UN to be totally open to a participatory approach, so to be open to discussion with civil society and with youth association. I think it's very important for journalists to be nuanced and to bring stories from the field. I really believe that everyone can, in a way, support by opening up this to real language, real words, to be concrete and to also be more creative. I really believe that, for instance, we'll have a film festival on migration starting next week. A lot of these films will be about climate change and migration, and already going and informing yourself about that. I think it's already a wonderful step ahead.
Absolutely. So would you share with everyone the IOM website where they can find out more info?
Yes, of course. You can find us also on the genericiom.int website, but we have also an environmental migration website. So if you just type environmental migration, you should arrive on our web pages where you'll find a lot of evidence and articles and also update information on the COP. And then the campaigns we have, you can have the campaign Find the Way, or we have another campaign which is called Do the Right Thing, and that also shares very interesting stories of environment and migrants. So you can access all those.
Perfect.
And if you do so, I just thank you.
Yes, and we thank you for being here, Dina. And for everybody out there, you can find out more information about the SDGs at sustainabledevelopment.un.org. And we'll be back tomorrow with more from COP25.
Thank you.